Hey all, welcome to Share Trek. This is Raj here. Friends, I was going to make a BNAB video today to complete the series of the BNABs that we have been covering. But then we have some good news, and I thought it's better to share the good news and put a bit of a break on that BNAB, because anything continuous becomes monotonous. But today we're going to talk about the latest news that one more person has been cured, potentially cured of HIV, thanks to stem cell transplants. So, with that said, let's get started. Welcome back, friends. We stand at the brink of a groundbreaking moment in the fight against HIV. We got genetic tools that are being deployed, like CRISPR-Cas9 and various kind of gene editing, RNA solutions. And we are also having a lot of small molecule and other kind of interventions to put a control on HIV. So in that backdrop, if you look at the fact that another person has been cured of HIV, that's kind of motivating. Of course, it does not push the envelope for a cure for everybody, because these are all specified special situations in which the cure has happened. But let's examine that. A German man who has chosen to remain anonymous has likely been cured of HIV, and it's a monumental achievement that has been realized by only 6 other individuals over the past 4 decades. This incredible news brings renewed hope and optimism to millions around the world. The German man's journey began with a stem cell transplant in October 2015, a treatment he received for acute myeloid leukemia, or AML. Remarkably, since ceasing his antiretroviral therapy in September 2018, he has remained in viral remission with no rebound. Extensive testing has found no viable HIV in his body, suggesting a possible eradication of the virus. Reflecting on his journey, the man stated, "A healthy person has many wishes, a sick person only one." His words echo the profound impact of this medical breakthrough, offering inspiration and hope to those living with HIV. The case will be presented by Dr. Christian Gabler of Charity Universitas Medizin Berlin at the 25th International AIDS Conference in Munich. Dr. Gabler emphasized the significance of these findings, stating the longer we see these HIV remissions without any HIV therapy, the more confidence we can get that we are probably seeing a case where we really eradicated all competent HIV. While it's important to acknowledge that this treatment is not yet widely available due to its complexity and risks, the health implications for HIV research are profound. Stem cell transplants, though currently reserved for treating severe conditions like blood cancer, have shown the potential to completely eliminate HIV in certain cases. The German man's case is particularly interesting because his donor had a unique genetic makeup that may have contributed to the success of the transplant. Dr. Sharon Levin from the Peter Doherty Institute for Infection and Immunity highlighted the broader implications of this study, noting that it suggests the potential to expand the pool of eligible donors for similar treatments in the future. This could be a game changer in making such life-saving therapies more accessible. Moreover, recent cases, including those of the Geneva patient and others, are raising critical questions about the factors necessary for a successful HIV cure. Dr. Stephen Deeks from the University of California, San Francisco, expressed optimism that these cases could lead to new insights that may shape the next generation of cure studies. And as one celebrates the milestone, one should be reminded of the extraordinary journey of others who have been cured or are in the brink of a cure. Their stories, like those of Timothy Ray Brown, Adam Castello, and the New York patient, inspire many PLHIVs to believe in a future where HIV is no longer a life sentence, but a challenge that has to be overcome. In conclusion, the German man's probable cure or potential cure of HIV represents a beacon of hope in the ongoing battle against HIV. It underscores the incredible achievements in medical research and the relentless pursuit of a world where HIV is eradicated. This news is a testament to human resilience, scientific innovation, and the unwavering hope that drives us forward. Now, after every video I have made about these kind of cures, the comment section I always find, when will a stem cell cure be available and how much does it cost? Now, I consider those very, very lazy questions, because if somebody is suffering from HIV and if they ask that question, then I think that they are being too lazy and they are not doing justice to their condition. So at this stage, I expect that everyone who has HIV would understand what is involved in the stem cell therapy. Well, when a stem cell replacement is done, it's a very, very invasive process. And it has been allowed only for certain circumstances where things are life-threatening, like, for example, cancer, and also in sickle cell disease, where we have bone marrow ablation and then replacement of that with modified stem cells. So those are the two instances where it has been used. In case of cancer, I mean, a person can die just because of cancer. So it's imperative that bone marrow transplant is done, because bone marrow is where those blood cells are created. So they want to correct the original copy, which is created by the bone marrow, so that the blood cells that come out of the bone marrow in future do not have cancer in them. So that's the logic. And when it comes to sickle cell disease, the problem for patients of sickle cell disease is that they need a blood transfusion every month or month and a half. And that exposes them to HIV, hepatitis B, and other blood-borne diseases because of the frequent transfusions. And they have very, very difficult events, vascular occlusive events, which are very painful. And the cost of living for such people goes up because they can't consistently perform in their profession. Their productivity is lower, and they have to spend a lot of time in the hospital every year. So those circumstances warrant myeloablation and replacing the stem cells. But when it comes to HIV, we have ART, which is able to control the viral loads, and therefore, at this point of time, stem cell replacement is not warranted. And if stem cell were to be replaced, the way I would imagine the therapy that might happen is that there would be donor stem cells that would probably be taken. And however, if a stem cell therapy were to be derived, the way I would approach that is that I think that probably the stem cell of the patient would be taken, and it would be modified. The harvested stem cells, there will be a backup stored away in case the modification fails, so that the original stem cells can be put back into the bone marrow of the patient. So there will be two batches of stem cells harvested, one for backup and one for modification. And the modification that I think they might make out there would be removing the CCR5 receptor probably that's one of the major modifications that might happen out there. I don't know if they would modify the CXCR4, which also is another portal for entry into the CD4 T cell. But at the very minimum, they might probably remove the CCR5, and then they will have to perform myeloablation. This is almost a month of hospital work, where chemical agents will be put into the body so that the bone marrow can be emptied. So the very first stage will be giving medicine so that they can collect stem cells from the blood. And then the second stage will be clearing out the bone marrow. And the third stage is putting the modified stem cells of the patient back so that it can engraft itself into the bone marrow and start creating new modified CD4 T cells. So that's the way I am thinking a potential solution might come through. And it is simplistic thinking. And remember, guys, I'm neither a doctor nor a scientist. I'm speculating on this possible approach based on everything that I have read and presented to you so far regarding HIV. Now, if that was to be done, then I think it's going to be a very expensive therapy, because it's an allogenic therapy, and it might probably use CRISPR or TALENs or some other gene editing method in order to make the edits within the CD4 T cell. And that's where I think we find AGT-103. AGT-103-T takes the stem cells, takes the CD4 T cells and modifies. But the solution I'm talking about is to take the precursor cells of the CD4 T cell and make the modification there, so that the CD4 T cells produced by the bone marrow going forward would all be without CCR5. So that's the potential solution. And if a therapy is expensive because it is gene therapy, it's not going to be viable to handle this disease, because more heavy HIV load is found in lesser developed countries, and where the economy is not that strong to support high price for these kind of therapies, which may run into millions of dollars per patient per dose. So we look forward to more technologies coming through. And I'm looking forward to Dr. Eric Art's HLP kind of therapy, which would be as simple as a regular vaccine administered intravenously. It won't be too much of a problem for the patient. It won't be a problem to manufacture. It will be inexpensive, and it will have geodiversity. It can go all over the world without special storage needs or the need for specialized personnel. So that's my thought process, friends. You can put what you think in the comment section below and have a discussion among yourself. So with that, I would like to wish you a very, very happy weekend, and I'll catch up with you again in the next video.